Today we feature Jerry DeWitt speaking on building atheist community. Jerry was a pastor in the small town of DeRidder, Louisiana, and a fixture of his community. He lost his faith in 2011. When he was eventually outed as an atheist, he found himself shunned by much of his community, lost his job, much of his family, and nearly everything he'd known. That is not an easy thing to encounter, and it would be really, really hard for most of us. Jerry has came back completely. He's now a leader, a well-known spokesman in the secular movement. He has spoken a number of times at American Atheists conventions. You going to be there this year?
If schedule permits.
Okay.
But I'm not.
Memphis.
Yep.
His book, Hope After Faith, tells the story of his life passage from a pastor to an atheist activist driven by a sense of humanism, a profound moral dimension, and the happiness and self-confidence obtained by living free of supernaturalism. That's a quote from his website. So, please welcome Jerry DeWitt.
So it's my pleasure to follow Hitchens. How exciting is that? How many know my story already? Most of you. Very, very good. Okay, so I'm going to be a little particular about how I lay out my story. This is a new experience for me. Normally, over the last 2 or 3 years, and I already feel the itchiness to move around the congregation, so stay with me. Cameraman, I'm terribly sorry. Yeah, I got my drink. It's just something about this podium. I begin to feel like I might just have to preach. We haven't taken up the offer yet, though, have we?
That's later.
That's later.
That's
okay.
Later.
All right. Well, we'll wait for the preaching till after the offer. So, if you know anything about my story, then you know that for 25 years I was in the ministry, various forms of ministry. When I was 17 years of age, a dear friend of mine, someone that I had fallen madly in love with whenever she was my fourth grade teacher, invited me at the age of about 16 to follow her to a camp meeting, a youth camp meeting, in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, that was hosted at Family Worship Center, pastored by none other than Jimmy Swagger. Where were y'all at back then? And so I got saved in that camp meeting and immediately felt compelled to go into the ministry. I was truly, for lack of better words, I was truly a lost soul at that age. And there was something about the environment, there was something about the message. It fit well into my youth, it fit well into my history. My grandparents were very religious, they were Pentecostal, they had raised me in and out and around the church. And so when I walked into this huge sanctuary, at that time would seat 8,000 people, and it was overflowing, and that was a mega church back then, and that's not even a mega church anymore. But when I walked into that sanctuary, and there was all of these other young people, all of these other teenagers and elementary school kids that were so enthralled by the atmosphere, I was, of course, given my raising, immediately drawn into this situation. Trust me, all this ties into what I'm going to talk about eventually. And so it was understandable that I was compelled to say the sinner's prayer and to get saved. And it fit. It fit into my life. It fit into how I had been raised. Some of the earliest memories that I have, and I still have ear trouble today, so if I get too loud, it may not be that I'm preaching. It's just that I can't modulate. But some of my earliest memories is laying my head on my grandmother's lap when I was a very, very small child. And she would hold a warm washcloth against my throbbing ear. And she would pray for me passionately, quietly, lovingly, but passionately enough that she would begin to speak in other tongues. And I always make the joke that some of my first words that I learned were inaudible, and it explains a lot about my vocabulary today. And so, It was natural that I would become saved. It was natural that I would fit into this. It was natural that I would feel compelled to join this army, as it were, and to march across the country delivering God's message and hopefully making the world better, if not this life, as Hitchens mentioned, in the next life. That's my story. That's the little intricate pieces of my life that creates an overarching narrative that took me from one place to the next. And each one of us possesses our own stories. We all have our own narrative. And those pieces fit together and they explain why we moved from this area to that area, why we met and then married this person or that person, and why we ultimately became non-believers or people who no longer believe in the supernatural. There's a narrative, there's a story to fit that. So for the last 3 years, I've traveled around the country telling my story, telling exactly in detail how all those things transpired. But for this particular tour, I was asked that I might dig a little deeper into my background, my experience, and talk a little bit about how to build communities. Because right now, if you're not aware of it, I'm definitely aware because I'm traveling across the country, visiting multiple different types of communities, atheist, non-believing, humanist, free thought communities across the country. And everyone is trying to draw from the ex-preacher phenomenon that's happened over the last few years. And they're trying to draw from that experience and say, teach us how to build these communities. And it's actually very simple. And I've already told you the secret in my lead up. And the secret to building a community is telling a story. And it's having a story to tell. One of the reasons why that we struggle in the secular movement to build the type of communities that we see in the religious world is because our stories are not as organic. They haven't originated from out of our culture in the deep, rich way that the religious experience grows and forms in most people's lives. Instead, we somehow come together over these common issues. We're standing most of the time. It's my take that the secular movement probably would not even exist if it was not for the power that the right-wing political machine has in our political landscape today. Because so much of our activity within the secular movement is a reaction. It's reactionary to what's going on all the way from the Supreme Court down. And that causes us, that generates within us a need to rally together and to build voting blocks and to have a voice and express a different opinion and tell people that we're here. But that doesn't seem to resonate and build the same type of communities that a religious experience, the way that it resonates and the way that it builds communities. So I'm going to give you just my few little insights on how this can be done. So, a couple of questions. First, my question would be, why do you even want to build community? And everyone's going to have a different answer to that. And trust me, since I've been out building, you know, secular communities for the last 3 years, I've met several people that will tell you very plainly, they don't want to build community. They don't need community. This is a stretch for them. Just attending this kind of meeting once a month and listening to a lecture for an hour is all the social experience that they need in their life. Right? You know who those people are. I see you nodding your heads. You know exactly how that works. And they always gravitate towards me, I can promise you, because they're not real thrilled with all the things that I do. So why do you want to build community? What's your desire? What's your motivation? Why build it in the first place? And then the next part of that question would be, what do you mean by community? Because as I travel across the country speaking to different secular groups, and they're all like, oh, we want to build community, we want to build community. I look out in the audience, and I see people who are connected already. I see people that have made friendships, they've created friendships, they have deep friendships within that group. And if they were to end up in the hospital, then somebody in that group would know that they were in the hospital. And somebody in that group would then tell the rest. And then people would begin to rally around and possibly visit or do whatever. Not all groups. But I've got some news for you. That doesn't happen in all churches either. But I see community. In the secular movement, I see lots of community. So maybe we feel the desire to build community, or we feel as if we have a deficit for some reason because we're not using our terminologies correctly. And then lastly, the question that I would ask you would be this. If you want to build a better secular community, what price are you willing to pay for that? What are you willing to do? How much energy are you willing to spend? How much money are you willing to spend? Because the reality of it is that not all churches, and I have seen hundreds of churches. I spent the first half of my ministry literally bouncing all across the country evangelizing, going from one church to the next, some small churches that might have 20 or 30 members, all the way to churches that would have a couple of thousand members. I bounced around and stayed in those preachers' homes and been behind those pulpits and went out to dinner. I could be honest, they never took me to King Dong, but that's a different... Maybe they did, they just didn't call it that. I don't know. But the reality of it is that not all of those churches were very good at having a real community. As the evangelist, I would sometimes be privy to people's opinions that they were not comfortable to share with the pastor, the leader of the church, the person that they were trying to impress. And so I would feel complaints that most people didn't hear. And I would hear, this church doesn't care about me. This pastor doesn't care about me. All this pastor wants is just the money. It didn't happen a lot or all the time, but it did happen. And so it's important for you to understand that when you are found with the desire to build a better community, a better secular community, that comes with a price, and not everyone is doing it, and not everyone can do it well. And the people who do it well, at least from a religious perspective, from a church perspective, are the people who institutionalize a philosophy to pay the price to build that community. What's the difference between a secular group's care network and a church's care network when we're comparing a good church with a secular group? Well, that good church, if we're defining good based off of community building, that good church has institutionalized safeguards, has institutionalized the ability to create a safety net so that people being tended to, their needs being met within the congregation, is not dependent upon happenstance. It's not dependent upon just some friend who happened to notice that you didn't attend the last 3 months worth of meetings, or they stopped getting texts from your calls. Instead, there are people that are institutionalized within that structure that it is their job to know whether or not you're there. That's their job. Chances are they're not paid to do it. So this goes back to, what type of price are you willing to pay? Is there anyone within the group that would, every single time you had a meeting, sit in the back and check off names off of the roster, off the list, to see who made it and who didn't make it? And then is there anyone, most likely unpaid, who would spend the time that afternoon after the meeting to get on the phone and go down that list of names of people who didn't make it and call them and say, I noticed you weren't at the meeting today. Is everything okay? Is there anything we can do for you? That's the difference between a lecture series and a church. Yeah. Can I get a Darwin?
Darwin.
You'll give it to me before it's over, trust me. And so, it's that institutionalizing. It's, what are you willing to pay? How much work are you willing to put into it? The churches that I pastored, we didn't have large congregations, but we had tight congregations. People who loved each other and all knew each other and all tended to each other. And lots of energy was expended in order to make that happen. For 2 years, and probably the best 2 years of my adult life, my job was to be a house husband and to pastor this one particular church, Grace of De Quincy. And during those 2 years, and I pastored for more than that, but this is a particular 2 years that I'm talking about, my life consisted of getting up in the morning and immediately getting on the phone, going down that list, checking on each and every person, spending 30 minutes, 45 minutes on the phone with them. How are you doing? What's going on? What's happening? Oh, well, you know, such and such is in the hospital. Boom. Phone down, in the car, on the way to the hospital. Right? And now you sit at the hospital for 2 or 3 hours, and in hospital time, that's like 17 weeks. Right? And you show the attention. The church that I worked out of, Grace of DeRitter, the mama church, actually on the front of my book, I think I've got five books here today, four books here. So if anybody wants a book, wants it signed, then let me know afterwards. But on the front of the book is Grace of DeRitter. Those pastors literally built something within that community that had never existed before, a quasi-Pentecostal, charismatic Baptist, this non-denominational nexus of believers within this community. And they did it mostly from hospital visitations. The biggest medical center near us is 3 hours away. I've seen the senior pastor of that church. We call him senior pastor, right? I've seen George Lee Glass, at 70 years of age, get up at 4 o'clock in the morning to drive 3 hours to the hospital in Houston to be there so he could hold the hand of that church member as they went under anesthesia. That makes an impression, right? That changes people's lives. But how does it change their life? And like I said, I've already given you the secret to the whole thing. How does it change their life? How does that fit in? It's because it becomes part of their story. Now, via senior pastor and his red eyes from no sleep and driving 3 hours to the hospital and his weariness of being there, through that person, through that institutionalized character, through that experience, that person's story is now changed. Its attitude, it's richer, it's deeper. And now their connection to that building, to that church, to those people, to that belief system, is a little more cemented than what it was. Now, the only reason that it worked as well as it did for the Glasses, senior pastor and his son, George Lee, the only reason that it worked as well as it did is because they meant it. Because they actually did love those people. And because they actually did care about what those people thought and what those people were thinking when they went under anesthesia to go for that surgery. They actually cared about the condition, the emotional condition of the family members that were sitting around, right, in the waiting room waiting for the person to come back from surgery. They cared about that. And why did they care about it? Because that was their story. Because that's who they are. That's the narrative of their life. And it intertwines in a very rich and complex way with the stories and narratives of the next person's life. And all those people fit together very richly. And so the next time that someone is in the hospital, it's so much easier for that person who was tended to correctly to expend the energy, to go the extra mile, to connect. So it's no wonder that in so many ways, in the secular movement, we always say this, every single group leader, Larry hasn't said it to me yet, so I'm about to spoil my record. Because because we haven't had the chance to talk long enough. But I would almost bet this day's honorarium on this. That every single secular leader that I spoke to says, you know what, it's like herding cats. Right? Why do we reference it as if it's cats? Because of the independence. Right? The independence. I'll show up if I want to show up. I won't show up if I want to show up because I ain't going to get in trouble with nobody. Right? Can't nobody tell me what to do. I'm through with people telling me what to do. People tell me what to do in religion, but I'm free of that. Now I don't have to do it. And then we sit around and we wonder, why don't we feel the sense of community that we think we should feel? Because you're not sitting in the waiting room. You're not building the story. Now granted, that touches on a very important part of our structure. Our independence is a foundational stone within the story that we do have and we do share. We now are free and we no longer feel as if we have to do this or we have to do that. It is generally some type of political ignorance that actually motivates us to come together, rally together, and walk forward together. And it does happen when it needs to happen. But it's not quite institutionalized the way that it is in the church world. That independence, one of the reasons why that we're able to have this and it doesn't exist in the church world is because when we look at the very origins of religion, when we go back as far as we can and we try to understand the mind of religion as we see it today, and we take ourselves all the way back to the Axial Age, right? The time within world history where there were great changes going on. We've got the Moseses of the world, right? Zoroaster, we've got that going on. We've got Confucius. Later we'll have some Buddhism. We've got the big changes. The big changes are taking place. The Axial Age, as it's known. What we see in the foundation of religion is this cosmic maintenance theory. Right? Everybody familiar with cosmic maintenance? That the world is complicated. There's jeopardy. There's jeopardy involved in the world. Sometimes the crops make it. Sometimes the crops don't make it. Right? And so the only way that we can ensure that the crops will make it, just to use one example, is that we have to get involved in God's business. We have to become partners in the cosmic maintenance. And if we will fulfill our rituals, if we'll go through our rituals, then God will have the help that they need, or God will be pleased with us because of our actions. We will participate in this cosmic maintenance, and the crops will flourish, and everybody will live happily ever after. That is core within religion. This partnership. Working with God, working for God, for the greater good. And it creates an us versus them, right? Because there's the those of us that are working for the greater good, and then there's the them that are not working for the greater good. So they're not part of the solution. That makes them part of the problem. So there's an us versus them. There's a group mentality. And even if it's not an us versus them, in the more liberal churches, it's a us versus that. It can be something as important to all of us as poverty. You can have churches that build very, very strong communities based on a cosmic maintenance philosophy that's very, very advanced, very modern, very liberal, that says it's us versus poverty. And that narrative ties all our stories together. Right? And now it matters to me in a deeper way than what it would have without that piece of the narrative. So what I would suggest to you, one of the necessities for building a stronger community is to first off understand that it's not a given. Building a community is not a given. There's no easy fix. Not only do secular movements or secular organizations not always get it right, but churches don't always get it right. The last statistic I saw was a very, very long time ago. And the statistics said that over 70% or around 70% of all churches in the United States had 100 members or less. It's probably changed over the years since I read that. But it speaks towards not building a very strong community, not growing a very large or strong community. So it's not a given. But the next, and to me the most important lesson is this, is that you have to get your story straight. You have to get your story straight. You have to understand, does this resonate with anybody? Now can I get a Darwin?
Darwin.
There we go. And so you have to get your story straight. You have to have a feel for what it is that you're doing. Now, I'm going to tell you that an important element of that is you have to know your market. Who lives close enough to you that they'll attend the meetings, that they'll volunteer, that they'll show up regularly, right? Who lives close enough to your point of interest to do things effectively? And what story are they willing to participate in? More and more, once again, I keep saying the same phrase over and over as I go across the country, I see groups that are divided. Because some people within the groups are Hitchinites, right? They're ready to tear it up, tear it apart. Right? If they could, they would spray paint it on the sidewalks. Right? But then also within the group, there's going to be those that are kind of in the middle. And they're like, well, maybe there's a softer approach. Maybe there's a better approach. You've got to get your story straight. Because that church doesn't grow to 8,000 people. It doesn't have a care network built into it, institutionalized, that makes people feel like they're part of a family. It doesn't do that and also be divided. There's one story. There's one narrative. And every time that preacher gets up and every message that he preaches, it stays with that message. It stays with that narrative. And it reemphasizes that narrative. And when the visitor comes in, they don't hear something new or different. They hear that same message that has captivated the people who are still sitting there, right? The people who fit into that. And they get to choose, does that narrative work for me or not? And the majority of them will walk back out and say, that's not my narrative, that's not my story. But some will come in and they'll say, that's exactly right. We need to spray paint on the sidewalk that God is dead. I'm for this 100%. Right? And they stay with that and they'll connect. And it becomes part of their story. So my last point, and I'll open up for questions here in a minute. Is it too soon to open up for questions? We're doing good? Keep going? I could go forever. You tell me. Go for a little bit more. And so my next most important, or the next most important part for me is this. Is that there is a difference between, in the religious world, the service, right, the church service, meeting up at 10 o'clock on Sunday morning, singing the hymns, listening to the message. There's a difference between that. I know y'all need to go. Understand? I know y'all need to go. You're good? No. My friends are here. They got some other obligations. There's a difference between the church service and the services of the church. But one feeds directly off of the other. Because the money comes in due to the church service, the show that you put on. How good is the music? Right? How good is the preacher? What's the building look like? What feeling does it create? Have you ever wondered why churches are continuously building new churches? Because they're in competition with each other. Right? And building a new church does two important things. It approaches the first service, the actual how you have the service. You're always modernizing. You're always becoming more professional. You're keeping up with the church Joneses down the street, right? Y'all say that here, right? Keeping up with the Joneses. You're keeping up with the Joneses so that your church service is attractive as the next person's. That keeps people coming in. That keeps them giving in the offering. But at the same time, pointing towards building something new. It's actually one of the services that the church provides because it creates meaning for the people within the church. And when they give into the offering plate, they can see the vision that they're building something majestic. They're building something attractive. They're doing something positive. They're putting forth their energies towards the future. Those strategies work together in a very complex but also beautiful way. Psychologically beautiful. And so you can't underestimate how important it is that when people come in, and I'm going to say it, and I know you're going to hate it, but it's okay, because I'm right. It's important for them to be entertained. It's important for them to like the speaker. It's important for them, if you have music, for them to like the music. The person who broke all the records, you may have heard of this little-known minister named Rick Warren. Saddleback, California, right? When you go back and you read what Rick did an economic survey of California. First, he did an economic survey of growing communities within the country. And then he settled in on California. And then he did an economic survey within California, and he found that Saddleback had all of the right ingredients to just explode. And so that's where he went. Because that's where there was population. Because that's where there was money. Because that's where there were people to build a community. The next thing he did is he went in and he began to do a survey of people's likes and dislikes. What were the popular music stations on the radio? How did people dress? What were people's hobbies? This developed a phenomenon within Christianity called the seeker-sensitive movement. Where church planners would actually become sensitive to the seeker's likes and dislikes. Where up until then, I'm sure there, you know, everybody breaks the rules at different points, but by and large, religiosity's philosophy was, this is the message, this is what we wear, this is how we look. This is the music that I like. You either like it or you lump it. And by lumping it, I mean you go to hell. Right? But now there was a new philosophy. And the philosophy was to give the people what they want. And so his dress style, even though he was coming from this Baptist background that's very conservative, his dress style was shirts untucked and Hawaiian-looking kind of shirts, right, and casual pants and casual shoes, because that's what these people in Saddleback were already wearing and already wanted to do. And the music matched, and the whole thing was the perfect show, right? But the show has to be good enough for the money to come in so you can pay for the services. Because without the show, there's no giving. Without the giving, there's no giving back. Once again, I reference Grace Church in DeRidder, the church that I worked out of. They pour out tons of money. Tons of money. It would probably be fair to say that the majority of their budget is spent on programs, giving back, giving back, giving back. The money goes back and back and back. They put clothes on school children who can't afford clothes. They feed hundreds and hundreds of people on Thanksgiving and Christmas. They pay people's utility bills, right? They're there for the community giving. Now they've got two soup kitchens. For the money is poured back and poured back because they've got the best show in town. They receive the most in, and they've got the most to put back out. So the questions are this. What do you want from community? Why do you want community? What do you mean by community? And what price are you willing to pay for community? Because in so many ways, I think we've already got it. But if we're going to take it to the next level, then there's definitely changes that have to be made. And it's up to you to decide whether or not you want to make those changes. You also learn from Rick Warren's teachings. Not only did he publish The Purpose-Driven Life, but he published The Purpose-Driven Church. And he lays out how he built Saddleback. He lays out exactly the strategies that they use. Did you know that this exists in a very, very, what would be considered theologically liberal church? You can be kicked out of or kicked off of the roster of Saddleback Church if they do an audit and they see that you are not paying your tithes regularly. You no longer get a vote. You no longer get to participate in the ministry. If you're teaching a Sunday school class and you're not paying your tithes regularly, you don't teach your Sunday school class. You get moved. You get demoted to the third level of the church. So what Rick taught was that every church has a core. It has that 20% that does all the work for the benefit of the other 80%. That's the core. And it almost doesn't matter how large your church is. The core doesn't always grow. The core is the core, right? But then above the core, you have the church, or what I would call the community. It's the faithful people. It's the people who come regularly. It's the people who attend virtually everything that you have. You can count on their faces out there in their rear ends filling seats. You can count on them to give if you take up an offering or you have some situation that you're trying to help financially. They're going to be there to do it. But then lastly, the third level, and in some ways the largest and sometimes most powerful level, is just simply the crowd. The crowd comes and goes. But the crowd gives when they're here, when they're there. The offer plate passes and they put another couple of dollars in, right? The cult, true cult that I belong to in Des Moines, Iowa. Give me a break. I didn't know it was a cult before I got there. But the pastor taught a lesson, and I think he got it from John Wesley. He said that within the congregation, there were sheep, and then there were wolves, and there were goats. And he said the pastor's job is to drive out the wolves. In our language, that would be staying consistent with your narrative, with your story. Staying focused on your vision. You will drive out the wolves. They will become uninterested in what you've got going on. He was able to drive them out far more forcefully because of what type of cultish situation he was involved in. He would actually call them by name from the pulpit and tell them to leave the building. If you haven't done that, you haven't had fun yet, I'm telling you. You're just glad when the names are calling out yours, you know, when he got past the D's, I was like, but you can drive out the wolves by staying consistent, knowing what your story is, knowing what your narrative is, and being consistent. But then that leaves the goats and the sheep. And the goats are cantankerous, but they're not like the wolves. They don't eat the sheep. The goats are just cantankerous, and they don't deserve to be ran off, and over time they may evolve into a sheep, right? But the great thing about the goats, and this relates back to the crowd in the other analogy, is that you shear those goats, and you use the money from shearing those goats to help feed the sheep. But that takes strategy. That takes institutionalizing plans and putting people in place. It takes money. It takes giving up your money. Giving up some money to pay people to do things professionally, to institutionalize things. And as long as the secular movement as a whole thinks that we're going to change the world for free, then we're going to it's going to be the slow growth that it's been over decades and decades and decades. You want something fun? How many of you have, I think it's pronounced, is it Roku or Roku? Roku? Roku. How many, anybody got Roku? Do you know that American Atheist has a channel? Right? On Roku, they have American Atheist channel. Go to the American Atheist channel. On their channel, they have archived Madeline O'Hare. Right? Videos. And you can watch her in the 70s talking to Johnny Carson about the exact same things that David Silverman talks about on Fox News today. 40 years later. Same issues, same problems. You know why? Because change is not cheap. If we do not begin to pay our way into better communities, then we're going to be in a very similar place 40 years from now than we are today. There'll be a noticeable difference, but it won't be the difference we're looking for. So in summary, what is your story? What is it that comes natural out of you? Are you the type of person who could very naturally be there holding the hand of the person who is going into surgery? Is that you? Is that your narrative? Is that your story? If so, then you've got a place within the community. You have something very powerful that you can contribute that will knit people together. Do you have money that for some reason you think that you're being religious when you give it up? Right? I've been surprised. Some groups are so anti-religious, I've been surprised that they'll actually point all the chairs in the same way towards the podium, because to me that looks like a church house. You know, they want to be so anti-religious sometimes, I would think, why don't we just have sleeping bags laid out on the floor and we'll just lay down and talk, you know? Let's be as unreligious as possible. Somebody passes the plate and people, they bristle. Well, this is being religious. What is your story? And what is it that you can contribute? I barely graduated high school. Barely. I pastored a church that right before Hurricane Rita, we were bumping 100. That was the largest church that I pastored on my own. In a little backwater town, out literally in the middle of nowhere, a 3 hours drive to a decent airport. But you have brought me all the way over here from Louisiana. A nobody, a nothing, with no secondary education, with no fancy skill, which is...
But you look good.
I see me and you going to get along this evening. Thank you. But with nothing more to offer, but do you know why I'm here? Why I'm really here? Why you really have me here? It's because I can tell my story. And because I've got a story to tell. But you do too. And if you'll tell your story, you'll build community. If you're looking some way to help, then have you ever heard of Patreon?
Yeah.
I ask you maybe make a little note. Go to patreon.com/JerryDeWitt. You'll see how we're building our community. It's how we're telling our story. All right. That's as far as I can go. Thank you.
Q&A. We have a little 3:30.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's great. Believe me, an hour ago about that. What I'll do, do you want me to pick people or you pick? I'll pick folks, and if you see that I've skipped you a couple of times, just flag me down. And I'll try to repeat your question as well for the audio. So, yes, ma'am, you were closest.
I was just wondering how you discovered yourself to be a non-believer and what the consequences of that were if you feel okay.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. I definitely feel okay talking about it. Thank you. So here's the thing. The way that I describe my experience, the story of how I became a non-believer would probably be more interesting if there was that one event. You know, just that one major thing. But that's not the case. And I don't think that's the case for most people. Instead, I describe it like this. Imagine that you have a pot of water on the stove. And in 1986, at 17, when I got saved at Jimmy Swaggart's church, the water hit the boiling point, right? And it was boiling. My religious fervor, my religious belief, my confidence in the supernatural was overflowing. Right? Unbeknownst to me, as I investigated doctrine, and the first doctrine that I dug into, I come from a Pentecostal background. Everybody know Matt Delahunte? Yeah. I've been informed by him that I mispronounced my own denomination. He says, I love to hear you say Pentecostal. So now I don't even know how to say it anymore. So my denomination was very conservative, right? Very conservative. The men didn't have facial hair. We wore long sleeves. The women wore dresses. No secular music, no secular movies, no television. Obviously, you know, it's kind of like the old joke of why the Baptists are so against premarital sex, because they're afraid it'll lead to dancing. y'all haven't heard that one? Oh, I got something. You heard that one. And so, just substitute your own denomination and everything. And so, so we were very, very, very conservative. And part of that conservative belief system was that every single person on the planet, every single person who had ever lived through human history, if they were not baptized by immersion under the water, and the words recited over them in the course of doing so, I baptize you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. Okay, a little bit of infighting about whether or not you had to say the Lord Jesus Christ, or you could just say Jesus Christ, you know, depending on whether you want to be an infidel or not. It was important. But they had to be baptized that way, and they had to speak in other tongues. Yes, I've done that probably more times than I've spoken in English. And so they had to speak in other tongues, and then they had to live a very particular lifestyle. Get rid of the television, no more movies, nothing secular. I've even gone to churches where they were particular about what colors you wore. One church I went to, you could not wear a red tie. Some churches, the women, though none of them could cut their hair, some churches demanded that the hair be up. Some demanded that the hair be down. Some churches, the church in Des Moines that I referenced earlier, the cult, women could only wear nude shade pantyhose, no other color pantyhose, dark colors, you name it. Every part of your lifestyle touched. I have belonged to churches where you could not buy a new car without setting an appointment with the pastor, who would review your finances and then go with you to the dealership to help you pick out the car. Right. So this is the world that I grew up in. Well, what that doctrine produced was everyone who didn't do all of those things, depending on what all those things were, would go to hell, where they would burn for all of eternity. And immediately, that didn't work for me. I was just like, I don't see it. That's a heavy price to pay. You know, I thought, let's say you live wrong for 70 years. Why don't we just take them out of the fire after 70 years and kill them? You know, why do they have to burn for 70 million, 70 billion, 70 trillion years for a life led in rebellion for 70 years? So immediately I was bothered by that. So immediately I began to study on the doctrine of hell and found out that the King James Version, which was the only Bible that we were allowed to study out of, actually does not support the mainstream version of hell that I had been taught. And that then led me to wondering about the Bible itself. And before very long, I was studying the structure of the Bible, how the Bible came into being, This is all over the course of years and years and years and years. So, every time that I would discover something new that was outside of my belief system, unbeknownst to me, I was bumping the dial down on the stove. And the water was getting cooler and cooler and cooler. And I didn't know it. It's kind of like the reverse of the frog analogy, right? The water was cooling off and I wasn't aware of it. And so it wasn't until I became a senior pastor for the first time, and I was, and now all of these problems within our church community was my problems. Everyone there was like my own child or my own brother or my own sister. Whenever that little child would come up before or after service and say, "Morning, Pastor," I would get almost the same little tingle of satisfaction. Not quite, but almost the same level of satisfaction that I would get whenever I would hear my son say, "Dad." It was that type of love. Without that type of love, you can't grow that type of community, because that's integral to it. And so when it became my burden, what I slowly began to realize, and I detail all of this out in Hope After Fame, what I began to realize was that more times than not, I was having to justify why God wasn't showing up, why God wasn't on the scene. More times than not, I was in the emergency room, and the spouse had passed away, and I was with a grieving loved one, and I'm having to do the better life next time, you know, kind of thing. And so over and over and over again, because it was finally, I'd evangelized for years, and it was hit and run, kind of like it is now. I can come in here and say all of this, you know, outlandish stuff, and then Larry has to fix it over the next 6 months. Right? And that's the way it was evangelizing. I could come in and do my thing, and then the pastor had to fix it. But now I was the pastor, and I was having to deal with those problems. So very slowly, and it was the perfect storm, because suddenly I was in a church that was extremely, when I say charismatic, you know I'm not talking about good looking like me, right? You know, I'm talking about doctrinally, speaking in other tongues, the gift of healing, working in miracles, charisma from the Greek, spirit, charismatic. And so, our gifts. And so here I was confronted with this very, very charismatic church with all of these people's problems, and all of that just worked together for me to slowly come to a realization. The first realization I came to was that I did not believe the Bible was divine, right? And I came to that. And then from there I began to see that I did not believe the mainstream theology of Christianity. I actually became a universalist, where I believe that the sacrifice of Christ on the cross paid everyone's price of sin, and that everyone would ultimately be saved. And then eventually I realized I was not even a supernaturalist anymore, did not believe in healings, did not believe in miracles. And so when I lay all of that out, step by step, one of the ways that I've done it is, my first step was I believed that God loved everyone. And that's what people say, but it's not always what they believe, right? And so that was a big change. I believed that God loved everyone. And then I became a universalist, and I believed that God saves everyone. And then I kind of became this New Age kind of Christian, where I believed that God was actually in everyone, whether they knew it or not, right? That made altar services really easy. You know, you're less disappointed when nobody comes up to the altar when you believe God's in everyone already, right? And I've got some great friends that are that way. Anybody ever heard of Bishop Carlton Pearson? If you haven't, you need to look him up today. I love him. I mean, I could like kiss him on the mouth. I love him so much. Bishop Carlton Pearson, check him out. But that's where I was at. So God loves everyone. God saves everyone. God's in everyone. And then I get exposed to Joseph Campbell. And so now the next thing is not nearly as poetic, right? God loves everyone, God saves everyone, God's in everyone. But the thought then was, God is really everyone's internal dialogue. This is the human experience of where we're wrestling with our, you know, that we are, as far as we can tell, the only mammals that know that we are not going to live forever, right? And we're dealing with this, we're working our way through these things. So God is everyone's internal dialogue. And then, as I always like to say as a punchline, then you're just one good book away from God is a delusion. So that's how. Now you don't even need to buy the book, you know. Let me go kind of this way. Yes, sir.
Are there any groups, secular groups out there that are good models for us?
Yes.
That have achieved this level of community that you still have?
I think so. I think they are. And the only reason I say I think so instead of that I know is because I'm not there with them on a regular basis. But I think the Sunday Assembly movement, and I think it now qualifies as a movement because there's so many Sunday Assembly groups across the, not just the country, but the world. I think they are getting very, very good at that. Early on, the secular group that we built in Lake Charles, Louisiana, we didn't partner up with the Sunday Assembly only because the very beginning of our appreciation of what Sunday Assembly was doing, it seemed to be all about the service, and we were more concerned about the services. And so we just didn't take on that branding. You know, we didn't join up with them and become part of that franchise. But I think they've grown. I think they've grown to do that. You also have, out of Houston, Texas, you have Oasis. Now, granted, these are the types of things that the media is referring to now as atheist churches. But I can tell you none of those groups call themselves that. That's all just media trying to sell papers and advertisement, right? They don't even consider themselves that. Like we don't either. But Oasis in Houston, another clergy project ex-minister, Mike House, has done a great job with Oasis. Now the Oasis brand is kind of spreading a little bit. Now you've got Oasis in Kansas City that seems to be doing really, really, really good. Our little group, Community Mission Chapel, it doesn't do quite as good as others, I think primarily because I'm not there to tend to it. It's one of the reasons I emphasize the institutionalism and how it needs to be institutionalized, that there's somebody there to tend to it all the time. But it's, I think we've been fairly successful in doing these things. Now that's that side of the movement. You have groups in Oklahoma City that I think without the churchiness part of it, they still have very, very, very tight community. Been with them a couple of different times, and you can just tell that, you know, they're reaching out and meeting the needs of their members in unique ways. When I give the example of the hospital, the first thing that comes to my mind is I think they call themselves like the Society of Free Thinkers of Arkansas or something that's based out of Little Rock. And whenever one of their members went into the hospital, they made sure everybody in the group knew it. They organized visitations. They organized sending flowers and later on sending food when she got out of the hospital. And, you know, they did all the things that she would have seen done in a church. And I think there are groups out there that are doing well. The big thing they all still struggle with is putting out enough money. Mm-hmm. Let me come right here to the nice lady who likes my appearance. Yes, ma'am.
I really enjoyed meeting you today. And I really enjoyed talking, because I think that building friendship is the most important thing in life.
Yes.
Whether it's attached to a reasoning situation or not. But I wanted to answer what was said here. I said something about I had a friend that didn't want to talk about my belief. And why would I continue keeping her as a friend? She's one of the most valuable friends that I have. She has the right to be wrong.
Right. Within your friendship, she has that right. Sure, absolutely.
So I'm not about to throw away a friendship like that. In other fact, it's really, really stronger.
Sure.
When I was sick in the hospital, she was there first. Her fear of religion is not my problem, it's hers.
Right.
But I have to be here for her. If it ever comes to the fact that she will talk about it. So I want to be sure everyone knows I'm an atheist, and when I tell them, then I'm not going to change.
Right. You know, that brings up a fantastic point. What I've seen, when I have particularly young people during the Q&A ask me about, especially when I'm going to college, it comes up a lot because I speak on a lot of campuses. You know, they'll say, my mom and dad, they don't know I'm an atheist. Matter of fact, you know, I'm hoping I don't get caught in any pictures here, whatever. I'm afraid that if they find out, then they're going to cut off my funding for my education. I hear that a lot That may surprise you, but I've heard that numerous times. And my, they'll say, I want to come out. I want to come out as an atheist, but I'm afraid of this or that. And so I'll have to ask them, I'll say, well, what is it that you want to come out? Why do you want to come out? Because if it's their conscience, like mine was, right, and they feel like they just can't be the human being that they want to be if they don't start expressing their own truth, that's one thing. But what we all have to be careful of is it groupthink? Is it that she feels or he feels like they want to come out because everybody now in their social group has come out and now they feel like they should too? That sounds a lot like religion to me. And so what we have to be careful with is that even in a secular movement, we can act religiously. And one of the ways we can do that is by telling people who they can and cannot be friends with and under what circumstances and what they must do within the confines of that friendship. Because there would be people who would tell you that you are absolutely... I mean, I know people that would be so strong that they would say every time that you don't tell her you're an atheist and try to prove to her that atheism is the way to go, that you're lying to her in some way, right? Even within the confines of your own friendship. Well, that just sounds like more of what we've so bravely tried to escape. And so I applaud that, and I think that's the way to go with it.
Because these people are going to watch me,
sure,
whether or not I'm different than what they thought I was.
Yeah, and this is a very, very important fact. Thank y'all. Anyone who's got to go, thank y'all so much. This is a very important thing. When we were believers and we were on a mission to save the world and to save souls, that is all incorporated within the belief structure. But atheism does not possess the same type of belief structure that says we've got to save everyone. It just doesn't. Some people try to make it out to be that way, and there's evangelical atheists, and they try to make it be that way, but it just really doesn't. That's something different whenever it's that way. Yes, sir.
I'm a Unitarian and an atheist.
Sure.
And you see building community within Unitarians and,
absolutely,
and atheists. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Oh, well, sure. Absolutely. I don't know if I've ever been to a Unitarian Universalist church that did not already have a very deep community. I mean, that's part of it. I mean, the Unitarian Universalists, if you, and I know you know about their history, if the rest of you do not, the Unitarian Universalists, sometime back in American history, was the secular movement for America. America's actually been far more secular in its past than it is today. I know you already know that. We've lost ground and we're trying to regain. And in the midst of that, whenever you have the real rise of the evangelical world, the Unitarians were faced with a very, very difficult task because they had become so far away from the mainstream. They were losing membership, they were losing ministers, they were losing ground. And they made a decision, and it was their right to make decisions, but they made a decision that they would start letting in people who are a little more theistic-oriented. They almost were completely gone at one point in the Unitarian Universalist history. And as they began to let those people in, then the church, the stuff did begin to grow, because that was the fad, that was where America was heading. And so it created a Unitarian Universalist philosophy that is very, very open. And so you could, even though you might attend a UU church where 99.9 people there are atheists, and even the minister may be atheist, there still may be incorporated into the service a certain amount of recognition for other types of religious, beliefs and structures. That works for some atheists. It doesn't work for other atheists. But the point is that because they structure themselves the way they do, they institutionalize the care network, right? The services. It's institutionalized, it's not haphazard, it's taken care of, and it's paid for, right? And that makes it flourish, it makes it grow, and it keeps a continuity of story, of narrative. And so, yeah, I definitely... The only reason that I'm not a UU minister today is because I did not attend seminary. Had I attended seminary, then I would have went UU when I first became knowledgeable. Let's keep moving across this way. Had you already had your hand at once? Well, go ahead. You go ahead.
This is a very brief question, but can you explain speaking in tongues?
No. Yeah, I can. No. Well, there is no language. First off, there is no true language. The claim is that there is. There's two claims about speaking in other tongues. One claim is very, very bold. It says that the person who's speaking in other tongues is actually speaking a language that does exist somewhere on planet Earth. That's one claim. And that draws back to Acts chapter 2, where on the day of Pentecost, on the day of Pentecost, they were all, start me off.
They were all gathered together in one room.
Place,
they were afraid.
Right, in one accord. Right.
But they were of one accord, and little tongues of flames appeared above all their heads, and they
right.
started speaking in the various tongues of the peoples around the community.
Exactly. And so I was trying, if I could pull my King James up. On the day of Pentecost, they were one place and one accord, when suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a mighty rushing wind. There appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what he's referencing. Yeah. And so the way the story goes is that during the Jewish festival that was going on at the time, you had Jews from all over the known world, and they all spoke different languages. And so the way that God got out the message about Jesus Christ, his death, burial, and resurrection, and the gift of the Holy Spirit was through this speaking in other tongues. Suddenly these people gathered in the upper room, one began to speak, you know, something from the Chaldeans, another began to speak something that was more, you know, whatever. So they're actually speaking a real language, telling the message so the people can understand it. But it's a language they don't know. Okay, that's the first level. You hear stories about that happening, but you never see it happen. Right? You'll have missionaries come from Africa, and they'll tell these awesome stories about missionaries who went to a brand new tribe, and the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke to the tribe and told the gospel, but you never see it. Somehow none of it's ever ended up on YouTube, right?
Robert Tilton did it every day.
Every day. And so the other type of speaking in other tongues is called an angelic language. It's a non-earth language. And so what they mean by that is that the Holy Spirit, you're just speaking God language. And it gives an excuse for the fact that it truly is gibberish. It's truly made up gibberish. And the only reason that I don't do it right now to give you an example of it is because I made a promise early on I would not do it until my grandmother passed away. So, you know, if you're lucky enough to be the group right after my grandmother passes away, then you'll have the YouTube video of the year.
If there are two people in a room and they're both speaking in tongues, do they understand?
No. They can claim to. There's a claim to via the gift of interpretation, which is a separate gift. Now, Pentecostals like me, they claim that speaking in other tongues is a necessary sign that you have received the Holy Spirit, which means that you've actually been forgiven. So if you don't speak in tongues, you don't know if you've been forgiven. So if you get hit by the bus, you go to hell. Doesn't matter what you did, right? It's very, very tricky, right? So then if you want to make for a fun Sunday school class, do like I did when I was 17 and say, hope somebody don't have a tongue. And it's like, next. Yeah. Oh, sure. And as I did very much. And so there's another gift mentioned in Corinthians where a person is supposed to be able to interpret the tongues. Now, there's still the theological thought that gift should be, someone walks in here speaking German, none of us know how to speak German, I have the gift of interpretation of tongues and I suddenly understand German. Okay, that would be the clearest, cleanest, but that's not the practical way that it's practiced. Instead, what happens is one person begins to speak in other tongues. And I, once again, I'm not just trying to sell a book. I'm saying you need to hear this in the book because my co-writer helped me describe this very well. A person stands up and begins speaking in other tongues, and what it will do is when they do it in a particular way, it will get the attention of everyone in the congregation, obviously. Even with everybody speaking in tongues, everybody can be doing it, but there's a way that you do it, and you learn how to do it subconsciously, that everybody knows what's going on, and everybody else gets quiet. And now you've got this very quiet, reverent moment with this one person speaking in this foreign language, and they may claim to have the gift, or they may sit down and shut up, and someone else claim to have the gift, and then another person will stand up, and they will begin to speak in English, and it is the translation, supposedly, our interpretation of what has been said. And what's awesome is that in our circle, God always spoke in the 1611 King James. Which is really cool. Right. So let me keep moving this way. Who did we have over here that I've been missing? Let's start at the front and go back. Yes, sir.
Well, getting back to the idea of community, I've belonged to a lot of groups in my life. And and I started groups in my life. I can always see the general idea is that you get a few people that are the core group, and those are the people that bear most of the burden of deciding what things the group is going to do. Whatever.
Sure.
But the people that join the group have usually have a common idea of what they're going to do. For instance, the Sierra Club, everybody knows kind of what the Sierra
sure.
Club is all about.
Right.
Move On is a political group. Emily's List is another group. There's lots of hiking groups, etc. So with the issue that I think that I have with the groups that I know that are atheist groups in the Bay Area, so there's the East Bay Atheists, the Contra Costa Atheists, and San Francisco, yeah. I don't know what they really stand for besides atheism, which is nothing to me. It's like, well, you know, it's a one issue thing. So if somebody asks you, what are you? Well, I could say I'm an atheist, but that's only one little thing. That doesn't really mean a whole lot
right.
to me. And I don't know whether they're politically, does that mean they're politically liberal? Does that mean that they support resolving poverty issues, etc.
Right.
And I only know that by sometimes what they do. For instance, your group has done some food
sure.
Food things. So I only know that.
Yeah.
So I don't really know actually what these groups. So these groups really, as I see it, haven't defined who they are. You know, if they were humanists, then we could all look at a humanist book, but they don't really say that.
Right.
So I don't really know who they are. And I would really like to. I know the reason I want to belong to that group, and that's because I want to form friendships with people that
sure.
are of like mind.
And I think you're exactly right. And that's, I don't know anything about these groups, so I can't say anything about that. But what I do know is the majority of the secular groups, particularly the atheist groups that I've seen, because believe it or not, if you haven't been out there and experienced the variation that's within the secular group, right, or secular movement, you will have. I attended groups that they called themselves free thinkers. And if you said atheist or agnostic, they felt like you were putting a label. And so that was a no-no kind of word because you only said free thinker. And then I'd attend another group where they were agnostic. And if you said atheist, then they'd be like, you don't know that. You don't know. You can't say that. You can't say there is no God, so you're agnostic about it. And then there'd be a fight over that language, and then I'd go to an atheist group, and if somebody said agnostic, I'd say, all an agnostic is a wuss. You know, there's just somebody afraid of saying atheist. You know, and so I encountered, my life was torn to pieces. You asked what I lost. I lost everything. I had stopped pastoring, and I had taken up a secular job of working for a building official, because I had some history of that. And whenever word got out that I was an atheist, he at that time was my best friend, the boss was, and he fired me. And I was already in financial straits because I'd stopped ministering and left pastoring, so that already had something to bind. Suddenly he fires me, and word gets out all across town who I am and what's going on. And so I lost all our finances, our home went into foreclosure. We lost almost 99% of everyone that we ever knew in our family, all of our credibility and standing within the community. My wife eventually left, which she did come back, but she left over the pressure of things. So we literally lost everything. And I connected with Recovering from Religion. Anybody know the organization? Dr. Dale Recovering from Religion. And I became the director. It's a non-paid position, but the theory was that if I got out and beat the trails, right, in the secular movement, telling my story, people would donate to Recovering from Religion, and I could then get a salary. That was the hope. I'd have a job again, right? Well, it didn't work like that, which is one of the reasons I mention money all the time, right? It didn't work that way. Well, when I'm out there beating the trails, I start running into these different kinds of groups. And some are humanist, and some are atheist, and some are agnostic. So I quickly realized I needed my own little creed, my own little credo. And it's in the book, but maybe you'll like it, and it goes like this. I say that agnosticism is my conclusion, all right? After 25 years of being in the ministry, I got more questions than answers. Agnosticism is my conclusion. Atheism is my opinion, all right? First, I start off, let me back up. Free thought is my methodology. Agnosticism is my conclusion. Atheism is my opinion. But humanism is my motivation. So what that does for me is that gives me a direction. Because now, by being able to say humanism is my motivation, I can look at the humanist movement within the greater sacred movement and say, what are the goals, what are the activities, what are the things that we need to be involved in and do as humanists? And that goes back to the storytelling that we're talking about. I see many, many atheist groups that they are just now getting their story together, creating their narrative, because their origin was really about just having a safe place. Having a safe place to go and talk to other atheists and be able to watch Hitchens and enjoy it without fear of getting carpet bombed or something, you know, I mean, that's really what it is. But then ultimately over time, it has to evolve into the next thing, whatever that is. So yes, ma'am.
What would you, in terms of building community, I agree with you about Unitarian Universalism. I still am a member, but I'm a Junitarian.
Right, sure.
Pagan, Unitarian,
sure.
Agnostic.
Gotcha.
And I was very surprised moving to the Bay Area that all the Unitarian congregations are more God-oriented than anything I experienced in Southern California. So that's why I'm looking for different groups. But I agree, it was all, you could go there and do everything. You could be in a book club. You could do community service. You could crochet.
Right.
You could come to services. You could sing in the choir. What do you think is the first good step for a community to do? Is it a monthly potluck discussion group? Is it small ministries? You know, small sort of small groups?
I can tell you what I think.
What is the first step?
If I stayed at home and did not travel, the first thing that I would do to make Community Mission Chapel better and take it towards the community that we're really wanting is I would work very hard to establish a daycare service for children during the meetings, you know, Sunday school.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are so many families that would love to attend the meeting, but they have kids, and the kids just make it very hard to do. And so I know as far as the church is concerned, you will never, ever, 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 ever grow a church if you don't have somebody tending to the kids, doing something fun for the kids. Now, an easy out for this that already exists is Camp Quest.
Yep.
And so you connect with your Camp Quest leaders, your Camp Quest volunteers, and you say, look, we basically need a mini Camp Quest once a month when we have our meeting. Now, your logistics, your venue becomes a little bit of an issue because to do it successfully, now you need basically two rooms instead of one at a minimum, right? You're going to have your main auditorium where you do this. Then you're going to have another room that works well for the volunteers to take care of the kids. I also highly suggest that you do what I first recognized this with the Assemblies of God, that they instituted in their denomination a background check. So whoever's going to be working with the kids, probably Camp Quest already has that in place. If you're using a Camp Quest volunteer, you probably already got it covered. But if you don't, then you institutionalize. All of this is about institutionalizing. I hate that it's that way, but that's just what works. And I'm telling you, there has been a million different sub-movements within Christianity who thought they were going to be flyer child, do it our way, we're not going to have to do all this organization, we're not going to have to, you know, we're going to have little cell groups, and we're not going to call this guy pastor, we're not going to put that one up on a pedestal, there ain't going to be no money. They all go away because nothing works without organization. Nothing lives without organization. And so that would be the first thing that I would do, is I would let it be known that we can provide this service. And the service is, Mom and Dad, you can come, hear a lecture, do whatever, and we're going to educate your kids about science in the other room. And we're going to do fun things about it. The biggest events that we have, we're very fortunate that one of our members owns a nice piece of property. He is crazy about fossils. And so before there even was a Community Mission Chapel, he built, in a piece of his property, he built his own park. And it looks like a park. I mean, like a regular park, but it's over in his yard. And he has buried thousands and thousands of fossils in this park. And so one of our best attended events is we make sure everybody knows, and Mom and Dad brings their kids in the clothes that they don't mind throwing away later on, you know, because you'll never get all of the dirt out of those knees. And they come for a fossil hunt. And so the kids are out in the park, and they're doing a fossil hunt, and the volunteers are watching and taking care of that, and mom and dad's doing, you know, whatever else. A lot of mom and dads don't come hear me, they go do the fossil hunt. So let me, I'll come right to you. Yes.
I belong to Kolodash, and I belong to the Sunday Assembly.
Sure.
And I am traditionally Jewish, but I'm an atheist, and I'm looking for community, but I have never really totally connected. I love Kolodash, but it doesn't meet all my needs. And Sunday, the one thing that I'm lacking in my life, and I think Sunday Assembly hasn't really developed either, is tradition around certain things that happen, such as death.
Right.
And there was a member of the Sunday Assembly who lost their son, and I didn't like how that was handled. Mm-hmm. There was
No care network,
no caring embrace of that person, no honoring of that life.
Right.
And that's always been an issue in my life, and I tried to make up my own traditions. I have an earring in my ear for when my niece turned 13.
Sure.
But then if there were a lot of children, I would run
out. You look like a Ferengi. Can I get a witness? Ferengi? Anybody?
Darwin.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so that's the one thing that I struggled with.
Sure. And that's an important point. And here's where I see this going. And don't let me forget about ritual, because I want to go back to that in just a moment. So here's what I would do as an in-between. So here's another first step that you could do. You connect with a humanist chaplain, a humanist celebrant. You know, I happen to belong to the Humanist Society, which is, you know, a subpart of the American Humanist Association. That's who I'm licensed through. So I'm a humanist celebrant. I can do weddings and I can do things. You connect with a humanist celebrant, and people who truly have, and I know you're going to hate this language, but it's real language, people who really have ministry in their heart, right, where they want to minister, they don't always have to be paid. Right? They just need to be acknowledged. And so you can acknowledge within your group that this is our humanist celebrant. Okay? That person becomes the institutionalized person that when there's a death, or something like that, this is the person we turn to. They use their experience, their education, and they set up what we do next. Right? It's up to them. Like, for instance, in a church that works well, you are going to have, I mean, you don't even have to pay people to clean the church if you do it right. People within the church will clean it. But you just have to schedule it. You have to have somebody, probably somebody's going to be paid to make sure it's happening, right? But they're making sure a lot of other things are happening. But people will volunteer, and they will pay the church, and this will be their week, and that, or that, their month, or their whatever. The same thing happens with taking food to families who's lost a loved one, or people who are sick. You have that one contact person that this is their thing. And it's not that they just raise their hand in the meeting because they feel bad nobody's doing it. This is their story. This is their story. This is how they feel. This is what makes them feel like a good person. Are we closing?
Sorry. No.
Just an announcement. And so,
it's gone.
And he sounded a lot like the teacher over Charlie Brown. That explains a lot. He is Jewish. And so that's an important part of it. And that person can pay attention to those life-changing events. And you can build tradition out of that. You know, a good group needs to acknowledge when kids graduate from high school and from college. That's an easy one to do. You have a special event, and you bring your kids in, and they get the praise and adoration from all of their fellow, you know, secular folks that they did. Those are little things. Whenever a baby is born, somebody sends a gift on behalf of, you know, of the group, and there's an acknowledgement, and the people who care to do so go by and visit. You know, those are little bitty things that make a big difference because it is the story. So real quick with traditions. Some people absolutely hate the idea of creating traditions. Here's the great thing. You don't have to do it, right? Because there's no hell for you to go to if you don't do it. So you don't have to do it, right? And if anybody in the group looks down on you for not doing it, then they're acting religious, so why would you pay attention to them, right? So back to Hitchens. All this becomes, a good preacher makes it awful. So Hitchens' last public appearance was in October of 2011. We saw that he died in December. That was at the Texas Freethought Convention in Houston, Texas. A couple of months prior to that event, all right, so this is 2011. So May of 2011, I preached what would become my last Christian message. All right, I was already no longer pastoring, but I was still involved in the circuit because people knew me, and I was preaching for my wife's cousin. May of 2011. Just shortly after that, around that same time, and you can see all this in the book if you care to, I had my moment where I had to acknowledge that the water was completely cold. All right, I had to deal with that. Very, very depressed because I didn't think I'd ever be in the ministry again, and all I knew was ministry. And so, I connect with the Clergy Project. All right, everybody know about the Clergy Project?
Yeah. Yep.
Richard Dawkins, Daniel Dennett, Dan Barker, Linda Lascola. Great book out there called Caught in the Pulpit, written by Linda Lascola and Daniel Dennett. If you are to look at that, it's a great book. I mean, so it makes it awesome. So I'm involved in the Clergy Project. Now I'm building community in my little world because I'm in this Clergy Project. It's all online. It's all pretty much anonymous, but I'm talking to people about similar situations, like how most atheist groups start out. We're just complaining about our situation, right? But I find out that there's a possibility, even though he's so sick, that he may be at the Houston Freethought Convention and that Dawkins is going to give him the Dawkins Award, right? And so I have to go. So sure enough, Hitchens makes his way. They go and get him from the hospital and they bring him over. And completely emaciated, half the size of what you saw in this video. And so, little backstory very quickly is that when I decided I was going to go, my son didn't want to go. All this is very, very new to us, even though he came out a couple years before I did. So I scrounged up the money and I bought a VIP ticket. Okay. Then a couple of months later, and those were expensive, my son decides he wants to go. Well, now, I don't have the money to get another VIP ticket, so I call and I talk to Nick Lee, and Nick Lee lets him come in on the student ticket, even though it was a little late. So, we're at the banquet, huge banquet hall, as you've all seen, nice big hotel. And I take my seat with my son, just a general table, okay, because he's got a student ticket. In walks Dawkins and Hitchens. Hundreds of people. The place becomes deathly quiet. And everyone is in shock to see Hitchens and the state that he's in. They make their way to their table. I get goosebumps just thinking about it. And you can feel the love, you can feel the draw to both of these men, but to Hitchens in particular. And the thought that crossed my mind was, if in that moment, if a reputable scientist, right, if Bill Nye, NDT. If somebody reputable would have gotten up there and would have said, we know for a fact that if every person in here would donate a year off of their life, we can save Hitchens. It would have happened at a moment. The love was so strong. It's one of the reasons why I say we have community. We just haven't institutionalized the practices. That's all it comes down to. And so we're enthralled by this. They go and they sit down at their table. David Silverman, he doesn't even know this story yet. David Silverman walks over, because he's gotten there a few minutes late, he's been visiting, and he sits down at the table with me and my son and a couple of other people. I don't even know who David Silverman is at that time. That's how long this is. And so one of the people working with the organization, one of the organizers, walks up to David Silverman, who's sitting at our table now, and says, David, somebody who bought a VIP ticket is not sitting at the VIP table. Would you like to take that seat? So I sit there next to my son, who I didn't want to leave alone, which is the reason I'm sitting where I'm at, and I watch David Silverman get up, walk across that ballroom, and sit down next to Hitchens.
Wow.
In my seat. So, this is a big deal. This is all a very, very good deal. Take it stride. So I already knew Dawkins from the Clergy Project, and my son and I spent time up in his room before the event. I already knew Daniel Dennett and communicated back and forth with Daniel Dennett because of that. had sent a letter to Sam Hitchens and got Sam Harris, and got a nice letter back from him. So I had kind of, so all that was left out of the four, right? Everybody know what I'm talking about? Is Hitchens. And I've missed this opportunity. So I let it go. It's a phenomenal evening. Hitchens gets up and with a very raspy voice, still delivers with the clarity and strength that you would expect. Just phenomenal. Phenomenal. Dawkins, before Hitchens got up, Dawkins got up and read his speech because he's delivering the Dawkins Award to Hitchens. And every single sentence that Dawkins delivered was pure poetry. It was beautiful. It was beautiful. I don't know how many men on the planet could live a life as incredible as Hitchens to deserve such a poetic, almost pre-epitaph. It was phenomenal. One point I must add is that when Paul and I, my son and I, went up to Dawkins' room to visit with him prior to the event, he broke away from writing that very speech to visit with us. So all this beautiful, you know, interconnection. So Hitchens does his thing. They sit down, Dawkins and Hitchens sit down, they start taking questions. Have anybody seen this video? Was anybody there?
I saw the video.
You need to see it. And so they sit down and they begin to take Q&A. And Dawkins is doting over Hitchens. Doting over him. Worried about him the whole time. And so he keeps, are you okay? Are you all right? Is this too long? At one point, Hitchens answers Dawkins' concern, leaning up, you know, with his bite and says, I would like to stay a little longer if that's okay. There wasn't a dry eye in the house because everyone took it metaphorically. You know, it was such a moment. One of the questions was by a young lady, an elementary school girl. She gets up and she says, what books would you recommend? So Hitchens, in his classic way, says, where's your mother? And so he says, you and your mother come to me immediately after the event and I'll give you the list. So we all get through the dinner, we get through the whole thing. Paul and I are visiting with the people we're visiting with. Dawkins and Hitchens, their little entourage goes out that set of doors. We're back on the father's back set of doors. When we finally get through visiting, Paul and I with all our new friends, because that's the very first conference I'd ever gone to. Very first atheist experience like that I'd ever had. We step out the side doors and we notice down the corridor there's a throng of people. Quickly realize, in that crowd is Dawkins and Hitchens, trapped down in the middle of that, because he had told the little girl to get her mom and to meet him afterwards, and so everyone else came along, right, for the party. So we start moseying that way, feeling a little sympathetic because we knew they were trying to get Hitchens back in the hospital. Am I boring all this story? Is this okay?
No.
And so, it's in the book, by the way. So nobody asked about the book, I take them. So as we're walking that way, another volunteer, one of the organizers, a nice young lady, she comes up, she stops next to me for whatever reason, and she says, I'm trying to get Hitchens back to the hospital, but I've lost my voice from yelling. Nobody will listen to me. So I've got three of the four, right? Without thinking, I grab the nearest straight back chair, spin it around, I stand up on top of it. And in my best preacher voice, may I have your attention, please? The hotel needs everyone to vacate the corridor. And the crowd disperses. Hitchens looks over his shoulder, and I watch Dawkins and Hitchens go into the elevator. And that was enough. And that's my story. And that, you enjoyed it, and it makes connection. It's about the story. I don't even know why all I told this story. So we still got maybe 10 more minutes, and it'll be 3:30. Yes, sir.
I love your book, Barry. Where's your, not to get personal, but the whole deconversion thing fascinates me because I was a Christian.
Sure.
Just 4 years ago.
Right.
And where is your wife right now when it comes to her? I mean, is she still a Christian? Or I know she wanted you out of, wasn't ever really happy.
She was never happy with being in the wife. Right.
Where is she kind of at now?
What's interesting, thank you, sir. What's interesting about my wife is that my wife is about where she has been the entire time. she is just her. You know, she maintains a certain integrity. She has never been a supernaturalist. There was a couple of times in our evangelizing days that she tried. You know, I mean, like I can remember one revival that we held. The service got really, really, really good, and there was a lot of spiritual stuff going on. And it was kind of a weeping service, but in a joyful way. And if you haven't ever experienced that, then it's going to be hard to describe. But she was sitting on the altar bench at this little bitty church out in the woods, you know, maybe 50 or 60 people there. Thank you so much.
It was a pleasure.
Well, my pleasure. Anybody connect with me over Facebook? If you haven't already connected with me, I'll do my best to come there. But anyway, she sat down on the altar bench. Things got a little quiet. She began to sing in other tongues. And that doesn't happen nearly as often as the speaking of the tongues. And it was beautiful. It was absolutely beautiful. And because of my frame of mind at the time, I thought, yes, finally we'll be in one accord, right? You know, because how can two walk together unless they agree to speak anybody's language? And so there was a couple of times that but most of the time she just is her. And the only way that I can describe her, the best way I can describe her is the way she described herself. She left. Everybody knows from the story that she left. She came back to visit my son at one point, so she stayed at the house, obviously, when she came to visit. And I walked into the family room one night, and we were in the heat of the battle. I mean, we got death threats, okay? We got death threats. We got ugly emails, ugly letters. I mean, you know, we ended up in the New York Times twice. We ended up in Time Magazine, you name it, US Today. We were on two or three different television shows. I mean, there was a lot. There was just a lot. So we got a lot of attention, a lot of hate generated from it. And so we were sore. We were just emotionally sore, you know. So I walked into the family room. In my mind at that time, this room that she has left, abandoned, you know, because she left. She's watching television, and she's watching a séance. And to say that it pissed me off would be an understatement. Can I say that word here? Is that?
Yeah.
And I mean, would be an understatement. But, you know, two things. I'm a pretty mild-mannered person, you know. I mean, I stopped growing at 5'5", so I know how to get along. When you don't have reach, you don't start a lot of problems. And the other thing is she's tough. She's a country girl, and I would have never wanted to get too riled up with her anyway. And so I storm out. I do the husband pouting thing. You know, even though we're separated, I still, you know, hold what happens. So I storm out, you know, and slam the door behind me and, you know, try to make a scene, try to get her to ask what's wrong, right? And she does. And I explain to her, with everything going on, with all the people that hate us, with me getting fired and us going through into foreclosure and having to save the house through bankruptcy and through all, you know, I just lay out the whole case, you know. Being afraid, I was horrified for a long time of even going outside and cutting my grass. Because we live at the nice little end of this beautiful street, and it's a wooded area next to it. And I was never afraid of anyone in my town doing us harm, but I thought, because I'd get voicemails. I got off the plane one day, and there's a voicemail, and this guy says, "You never was a preacher, and all you're doing now is dragging other people to hell with it. Don't you think for a minute I'm going to let you continue to do this?" Wow. You know, and so he called from his own cell phone. I Googled the number, found out who it was, and he belonged to this militia group that was determined to take America back for Christ, even no matter what it took. And they were talking violence and all kinds of stuff. So when I get on my riding lawnmower, I mean, it would take every bit of courage that I had to stay outside on that riding lawnmower, because I thought somebody could drive 6 hours, get in that tree line, shoot me with a .22. Nobody would even make nothing of that pop because we live next to the woods. They would find me eventually and have no clue who this person was or where they came from. You know, so I was bitter. So I'm laying out my case, and you're going to come into this house with everything that's going on, and you're going to watch a stinking seance on my TV. You know.
Ooh.
So So she looks up. This is my answer to your question. She looks up and she says, "Jerry," she said, I'm not as much of a believer as I am a wisher. I just lost people in my life I wish I could talk to again. You know, and I thought, that's typical, that's how stupid I am, you know. But that kind of describes her. You know, she's got a little bit of fate, you know, wrapped up in there, a little bit of serendipity, but really not in any way that you could call her a supernaturalist and never was.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
I believe you said it, your son came out before you did it.
Yeah, and by came out, I say that a little using the wrong language. He stopped going to church. Even though, thank y'all very much. Even though he was, you know, the pastor's son, he stopped coming to church. Even though it was very much, thank you. Even though it was very much against our dress codes, he stopped cutting his hair. His hair is like down to here. He's 22. And he, you know, this all started happening when he was about 16 or so. Got a tattoo, which is a big no-no. And, you know, he just started being his own guy. And looking back on it now, he was expressing a lot, not just individuality and his own individuality, but he was expressing his lack of supernatural, you know, supernaturalism. So he's been my right hand man the whole time. Which leads to why I told you that story. So the tradition is in the grab bag, the swag bag of the Hitchens event was this. So my son and I each got a bag, so we each put it on at the same time. So this has been on both of our wrists, his on his, mine on mine, since October of 2011.
Wow.
And that's our tradition, that's our connection. It's like your earring. So part of human nature. Yes, ma'am.
My cousin Nadine married an evangelist by the name of, last name is Smart. Have you ever heard of him?
I don't know. What do you have any idea which denomination?
Church of Nazarene.
I don't think so.
It was interesting to me that he was born again out of a street gang, quote. And the family was so proud of the fact that he was now saved.
Mm-hmm.
And he loved taking his she was 4'10", very tiny.
Already like her.
And a marvelous musician. Even her family denied her going to Juilliard, where she had gotten a full scholarship.
Wow.
But he loved taking her long hair, it was in a pigtail, and she could sit on it for a little person, and twisting it.
Yeah.
But none of the family wanted to look at the anger in his motion.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I thought maybe you had heard of him.
I had not. But you know, it doesn't surprise me that he had an evangelist with problems. Because it's just people. You know, I mean, that's why I said earlier before the event even began, I don't see religion as a thing. I see religion as an experience that humans have and share. And it's just made up of humans. You know, it's just made up of humans. And we have to be prepared for that. We can't allow ourselves, thank you, ma'am, we can't allow ourselves to get religiously obligated in such a way that if you have an atheist group leader who suddenly gets caught, you know, being mean to his spouse, we can't set ourselves up in such a way that somehow discredits us or anything else, the way that religion has set themselves up for that, you know, because that's just not who we are. Are we good? I think so.
Thank you, Jerry.
Thank you very much.